Hey guys, hello and welcome to Excel Academy.
Hello everyone, welcome to Excel Academy. Today we are going to see basic circuit elements and their connections. Before starting the first unit, I want you to be familiar with all the basic terminologies and the basic circuit elements. To start with, first of all, what is the meaning of current? Well, current can be defined as the flow of electrons in any conducting path. And the current is of two types, direct current and alternating current. Now, let us first see what do you mean by direct current. Now, direct current flows only in one direction and its magnitude is constant with respect to time. Now, what is the meaning of that? So, this is how the direct current looks like. You can see that x-axis represents time and y-axis represents the magnitude. You can see that though the time is changing, the magnitude is constant. Fine. And secondly, it is positive all the time. Right. Now, I said it flows in one direction. Okay. So, it does not mean that always it is in one direction. Like now it is positive. Now, if we want in any application, suppose this is the time axis. Yeah. Now, this can be my DC signal, which is negative. So, the point here is either it can be positive or negative. It cannot be both. Another type is alternating current. Now, alternating current basically switches its direction back and forth. It means alternately it becomes positive and negative after regular interval of time. Another important point is its amplitude or magnitude continuously changes with respect to time. Now, here sinusoidal signal is shown. Fine. So, the signal magnitude is changing with time and as a function of sine theta. Now, it is not necessary that always the signal will be sine only. Even alternating current can be like this. Fine. This is a type of triangular wave. So, I hope now it is clear for you. Now, let us understand what is the frequency and time period. Now, you have to remember one thing, that DC does not have any frequency. The frequency of DC is zero. Fine. So, we are talking about frequency of AC signal. Now, time period. Now, what do you mean by time period? It is defined as the time required to complete one cycle. Now, what do you mean by one cycle? One cycle is, now if this is the sine wave, which is AC, this part is positive half and this part is negative half. So, one positive half and one negative half makes it one cycle. So, this is one cycle. Okay. Now, how much time is required to complete this one cycle gives you the time period. Fine. And its SI unit is seconds. Now, what is frequency? Frequency is the number of cycles completed per second. Now, for example, here, two cycles have been shown, right? So, this is the first cycle and this is the second cycle, right? So, the frequency is two cycles per second. Now, in another example, let us understand that suppose here you have 1 second, fine? And my signal varies like this, okay? Randomly, I am plotting any signal. Now, let us understand how many cycles it is completing in 1 second. So, this is going to be first, this is the second cycle, this is the third cycle and the last one is fourth cycle. So, I can say that frequency is 4 cycles per seconds. and its unit is hertz. Fine. Now, very important point is that frequency is the reciprocal of time period. Fine. So, f is equal to 1 by t or t is equal to 1 by f. Now, this relationship is very important, that reciprocal of time period is known as frequency and vice versa. Now, let us understand what you mean by resistance. Now, these terminologies we are going to use again and again. So, we have to understand these small points. Now, basically, resistance is a property which opposes or resists the flow of current. Fine. And this is how we are representing the resistance. The symbol of the resistance is shown. And the SI unit of resistance is ohms. Okay. Now, a very important law is there which gives the relationship amongst resistance, voltage and current. Now, what is Ohm's law? Ohm's law states that the current passing through any conductor is directly proportional to the potential difference. Now, what is potential difference? Potential difference is voltage. Fine. So, Ohm's law says that current is directly proportional to voltage. Okay. What else? Next it says that the current is inversely proportional to resistance. What does that mean? That I is inversely proportional to R. Fine. So together I can write that my current is directly proportional to V and inversely proportional to R. Okay. Or in other words, I can say that V is equal to I. This is another way in which we can represent Ohm's law. One more way is that Ohm's law states that the ratio of potential difference across a conductor and the current. It means ratio of potential difference is V and current is I. So it states that this ratio is always constant. Now when I say it is constant, actually that constant is nothing but R, resistance R. Fine. So, this is also giving the same equation V is equal to IR. Now, we have to remember this particular equation always. Fine. V is equal to IR. Now, let us understand how these resistances can be connected. If you have more than one resistance, then how can we connect it? Now, they can be connected in two ways. One is the series connection, another is the parallel connection. So, one is the series connection, another is a parallel connection. Fine. So, in the first way, series connection is shown. And what will be the total resistance? Total resistance will be simply the sum of all individual resistances. Fine. Now, important point here is, now how will I identify that what is series connection and what is a parallel connection? So, here you should remember that every component has two ends. Fine. Two ends are there for every component. Like suppose this is a resistor. Fine. So this is one end and this is another end. Let me take one more resistor. This is one end. This is another end. Now suppose only one end is connected. One end of each component is connected together. Then it is known as series connection. Fine. Now, let us understand then how will be the parallel connection. Now, as I said, suppose this is a resistor. This is one more resistor. Now, if both the ends of these components are connected together, then this combination is known as parallel connection. So, if only one ends are connected, series. If both the ends are connected together, then it is a parallel connection. Right? You should remember these points. Okay. Now, let us come to a very important point which says that current is always same in a series circuit, but the voltage is divided. It means whatever current flows through R1, the same current flows through R2 if they both are in series connection. But the voltage gets divided between R1 and R2. Okay. Now let us come to parallel connection. Now parallel connection, how the parallel connection looks like has already been explained. Now let us understand what is the equation for it. So in parallel connection, the total resistance is represented as 1 upon Rp is equal to 1 upon R1 plus 1 upon R2. So when you take the LCM of it, so you get 1 upon Rp is equal to, the LCM becomes R1 R2, okay, and here you get R2 plus R1. So when you take reciprocal of this equation, you get Rp is equal to R1 R2 upon R1 plus R2. So this is how we calculate the parallel equivalent resistance. Now again, important point is that if you talk about the voltage in parallel circuit, the voltage is always same, but here the currents get divided. It means whatever voltage is applied across this parallel combination, the same voltage appears across R1 and R2. Okay? But if you talk about the current gets divided. So if this is current I, it gets divided into I1 and I2. Fine? So here in parallel circuit, the current gets divided, and in series circuit, the voltage gets divided. Okay? Now let us understand what is power. Now basically, electrical power is defined as the rate at which the work is done. And numerically, the power is represented as the product of voltage and current. And there are some other ways to represent the power as well. Now, how do we represent that? So, by Ohm's law, we say that V is equal to IR. Or I can say that I is equal to V by R. Right? So, I know that power relation is V is equal to IR. Okay? And I know that power P is equal to V into I. Fine. So, what I will do is, I will keep the value of I here. So, V into what is I? V upon R. So, in this way, I get P is equal to V square upon R. So, this is the first relation. Secondly, again P is equal to V into I. So, here what I'll do is, I'll put the value of V. What is V? I into R, okay, into I. So, I get P is equal to I square R. So, these are the two relationships for power. One is in terms of voltage and another is in terms of current. Fine. And the SI unit of power is watts. Let us understand what an inductor is. Now basically, inductor is an element which converts electrical energy into magnetic energy. And it converts electrical energy into magnetic energy when current is made to flow through it. Okay, the symbol is shown and the series connection is also shown. Now we know how a series connection looks like and how a parallel connection looks like. Now, when you talk about the series and parallel connection of an inductor, the relationship is exactly same as that of a resistor. So, series equivalent inductance is again the sum of all individual inductance. So, I can say that total inductance LS, S signifies series. So, LS is equal to L1 plus L2, and similarly, in parallel connection, again, the relationship is same as that of the resistor. So, here also, I can say that LP, P stands for parallel. So, LP is L1, L2 upon L1 plus L2. Now, let us understand what is the meaning of inductive reactance. Now, if you have a resistor, the property of a resistor to oppose the current is called resistance. Now, similarly, inductor also opposes the current. Fine. So, that property is known as reactance. So, in simple words, I can say that inductive reactance is nothing but resistance offered by an inductor. Now, how do we represent it? So, reactance is represented by letter X, and since it is inductive reactance, we give a subscript L. So XL stands for inductive reactance. Now inductive reactance is represented as omega L. Omega is the angular frequency in radians, so which is given by 2 pi F. So finally, I can say that inductive reactance XL is equal to 2 pi F L. Now 2 is constant, pi is constant, and for a given circuit, L is also constant, right? So I can conclude that X is proportional to F, particularly XL. Inductive reactance is proportional to F. It means that the opposition is proportional to the frequency, right? It means that if any signal is applied through an inductor, if the frequency is less, the opposition will be less. And if the frequency is more, opposition is more. Now, what is the frequency for DC? In the beginning itself, I told you that it is zero. So, what is the opposition offered by an inductor for DC? Obviously, it is going to be zero. So, I can say that inductor allows DC. Now, what is the frequency of AC? It can be anything but a non-zero value. It means that it opposes AC, right? Because it is giving some opposition to AC. So, basically, you have to remember that inductor allows DC to pass through it and it opposes AC. Now, let us see how a capacitor behaves, right? So basically, capacitor is an element which stores the electrical energy in the form of charges, and the SI unit of inductance was Henry and SI unit of capacitance is Farad. Symbol is shown and the series and parallel connections are also shown. But here you have to remember that in series and in parallel, the equations are exactly opposite to that of an inductor or a resistor. Now, in case of inductor and a resistor, series combination was represented by R1 plus R2 or L1 plus L2. Whereas in the case of capacitor, parallel combination is represented by C1 plus C2. And series combination is represented as C1, C2 upon C1 plus C2. Fine? This we have to remember. Now, next, talk about capacitive reactance. Now, in the similar fashion, capacitive reactance is the opposition which is offered by the capacitor. Fine. So I can say that it is nothing but, in of course simple language, I can say that capacitive reactance is nothing but the resistance offered by the capacitance. Fine. Now here reactance is again represented by X and subscript C is used to denote capacitance. So capacitive reactance is represented by XC and it is given by 1 upon omega C. Fine. In case of inductor, it was omega L. But here it is 1 by omega C. So it says that X is equal to 1 upon 2 pi F C because omega is 2 pi F, right? So I can conclude that capacitive reactance is inversely proportional to frequency. Now, what does that mean? It means that if frequency is more, the capacitive reactance will be less, and if the frequency is less, capacitive reactance will be more. Now, what is the frequency of DC? The frequency of DC is zero. So, what is 1 by 0? It is infinity. So, I can say that capacitor opposes or blocks DC. Why blocks? Because it is offering infinite resistance. So I can say that capacitor opposes DC. So it does not allow DC to pass through it. But for AC, in household supply, the frequency is 50 Hertz. But it can go to any value depending on the application. It can go to megahertz, gigahertz, terahertz, right? So whatever is the frequency, the capacitive reactance will be inversely proportional to frequency. Fine. So it means that it allows AC, but it blocks DC. Okay. So this is it. We will be discussing all other things in the next lecture. Thank you.
Log in to our next video to keep learning.